Hey everyone, thanks for watching. I know Indy 5 or Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny isn't out yet, so this video might be presumptuous, but based on what has been leaked already, this video is all about what type of progression I personally would like to see in Indy 5. Now, this video does contain spoilers, but keep watching as a large part will be about looking at the previous Indy films. I will give you a good heads up when we are heading into spoiler territory.
Obviously, we've come to the right man.
First off, I wanted to talk about elements from the previous films. To go forward, sometimes we have to go back.
I don't mean going back to reminisce or chase ghost.
I've been a fan since I was 8 years old, and I remember walking past the TV at a friend's house spotting Raiders of the Lost Ark playing in the background. I remember not being able to place the genre of this film as I watched the truck chase sequence with intrigue. I saw what looked like a cowboy on horseback, and then all of a sudden, he was on the back of a military truck? Is this a war movie? A western? What was this genre-bending film? And at that point, the love for adventure films were cemented. What I love about indie films is that they are romantically told period films that incorporate fantasy, globe-trotting action, and romance. Now today, I will be attempting to fix Indy 5. Now I'm basing my suggestions on an already leaked plot, which I couldn't help spoil for myself. It's a fairly common leaked spoiler that have been circulating, and I won't be going into the details of it, but I will be using it as the basis of my argument, and will be looking at some of the major aspects of what I believe needs more work. But first, to try and fix something, we have to figure out what worked, and in order to do that, we need to establish three things from the previous Indy films. Number one, Indy's motivation for entering each adventure. Two, his character arc in each of the films. Number three, the prize at the end. The MacGuffin or the plot device that propels the story forward in each film is for the most part irrelevant. We love the quest for the Ark, the Grail, etc. They're fun. But let's look at some other elements that make a good indie film a great indie film. Yes, Indy goes through changes in each film, and for the most part he doesn't repeat the same lesson. When he doesn't repeat his mistakes, it deepens his next adventure. And at the base level, these films are about a swashbuckling, tenacious adventurer and his thirst for archaeological knowledge, but on another level, we see some change. To note, he's basically a James Bond in the world of historic antiquities. Spielberg wanted to direct a Bond film when Lucas said, "Why don't we do this?" Hence, we have the Bond-like prologues with its separate adventures and the hero-like dual identity. Teacher, lounge lizard by day and whip-cracking fedora, cowskin-wearing hero by night.
Supposed to be a lion tamer?
There's something about having a secret identity that is very alluring to a lot of people, as we'd like to tell ourselves that we too have a more dynamic and purposeful side. So let's start with the one that kicked it all off, Raiders. In Raiders, we see a whole bunch of cool stuff, but three things I wanted to touch on as mentioned. His motivation for the adventure, his arc or his character change, and lastly, his prize. In Raiders, it's initially his thirst for knowledge that gets him right into the adventure while undermining the power of the Lost Ark.
Lightning, fire, power of God or something.
He's thrusted into the adventure as a skeptic without having any belief in its power.
We've known each other for a long time. I don't believe in magic, a lot of superstitious hocus pocus. Going after a find of incredible historical significance, you're talking about the boogeyman. Besides, you know what a cautious fellow I am.
At the climax of the film, the only reason why Indy and Marion survive is because Indy became a believer. By closing their eyes, acknowledging the spiritual power, they survive, and the Nazis, well, they're toast. I'm sure Indy is now happy that he went to Sunday school as a kid.
Either you guys ever go to Sunday school?
And the prize, well, he meets Marion. A previous flame, they rekindle their love, and by the end, they are reconnected. So, to recap, he's motivated by knowledge, which gets him into the adventure. He goes from skeptic to believer, and lastly, a relationship with Marion is restored. Okay, Temple of Doom comes next, or does it? It's set in 1935, and as a kid, I thought, why do this? Why set the film a year before? Is it to enforce his James Bond-like persona and give him another girl, and not having to answer the question of why he'd just broken up with Marion, the love of his life, only to trade her for Willy? Oh wait, that happens in The Last Crusade.
of Venice.
But reportedly, the real reason is because Lucas didn't want Nazis in it again.
Nazis. I hate these guys.
So they shifted the story to 1935 India. Now, again, if we look at the three elements, his motivation for getting into the adventure was for fortune and glory. They crash landed in India and get told by the village elder that their sacred protective stones have been stolen, along with their kids. That night, it's only after Indy discovered the sacred stones were part of the lost Sankara stones that Indy was in. Indy had stars in his eyes and an archaeological interest, but saving kids were probably not front of mind. More of a perk at the start, that is. Now, the change in Indy happens at the end as he risks forsaking the Sankara stones in the river only for Mola Ram to grab it. Forcing his hand, Indy gets it off him, Mola Ram dies, Indy returns the stone and kids, forsaking his fortune and glory, and saying something like,
I understand its power now.
So, in the end, Indy did the right thing. Bit of an arc paradox here though, as after the supernatural events he experienced in Temple of Doom, he yet again needs to be reminded to become a believer again, in Raiders. A skeptic? So soon?
You will become a true believer.
But nonetheless, Indy learns to be selfless. He leaves the stones there in peace, and the prize? A proper date with Willy. In The Last Crusade, my favourite out of all of them, Indy goes on an adventure with the series' symbolical hero, James Bond, aka Sean Connery himself. Now, the selfless, believing archaeologist is back again at the college. After the opening scene, which nicely sets up the MacGuffin and his relationship with his father, or strained relationship, he has no interest in finding the Grail and refers Walter Donovan to his dad. But Daddy isn't home, so Indy gets worried and off he goes to save Dad. His motivation is one to rescue his dad, and then the film becomes a bit of a buddy film with Indy trying to win his dad's approval at every turn. Love it. Now, if saving Dad is the motivation for him to enter the adventure, the character arc is that Indy finally stops trying to win his obsessive dad's approval, as his father finally acknowledges him as an equal and calls him Indiana, and not Junior.
Indiana. Indiana.
Indiana takes note and realizes his dad's acceptance and love and forsakes his futile attempt to pick up the Grail. Funny the things we do for love, right? So, he enters the adventure to save Dad, Dad accepts son, and a relationship is restored, and they're off into the literal and proverbial sunset. Love it. Okay, so you're still with me? Crystal Skull, 19 years later. Indy 4 starts off on another adventure with some geriatric. His father has passed, and at least that ended well. We hope. He's still teaching and living a cushy life. He's older, wiser, and hopefully maybe his womanizing days are over. Enter Mutt Williams, who tells him about Ox, an old colleague of Indy that's missing, and again we're off on another adventure motivated to rescue someone. Interesting to note how Indy's motivation to enter the adventures have evolved as he, as a character, has matured. To look at them again in chronological order of the film's events, they are, number one, glory, right? Number two, archaeological significance. Number three, rescuing Dad. Number four, rescue a friend. Okay, back to Crystal. Enter Marion Ravenwood, who we find was left by Indy a week before their wedding prior to Mutt being born. Ouch. Indy walking out on the love of his life? This is definitely not one of the reasons why I love this character so much.
I think you gave up your vote on who I marry when you decided to break it off a week before the wedding.
As we all know, Mutt turns out to be Indy's kid, and fast forward to the end, and not only is Indy restored to his family, but he also gets married.
I love weddings. Drinks all around.
So if his motivation was largely a rescue mission, his character arc was discovering that family is more important than knowledge. What killed Irina Spalka was her desire for knowledge from the aliens, which caused her to, well, disintegrate. You can imagine that for an inquisitive archaeologist, this would have been very tempting. But Indy found something more important, family and friendship. And the result, or prize, was that Indy got his family in the end after all. So far, Indy's prizes in all the films are in a chronological order. Number one, a date. Two, a love restored. Three, relationship with Dad. And four, a family. And his character arcs, again in order, are number 1, selflessness, 2, belief, 3, security in his relationship with his father, and 4, family over knowledge. So can we see a trend here, a progression, an evolution if you like? Indy is growing up. Now, from my limited knowledge, this is what I'd love to see the producers build upon in the new one. Will this happen? From what I've read, it doesn't sound like it. But taking from what I know already, I will only make a few tweaks to fit this previously mentioned model. So, first, let's look at the motivation I'd like to see Indy have for entering his final adventure. Seeing the last two films was a rescue mission, why don't we start with something similar? From my understanding, Indy, of what I know from Indy 5, is that he is reluctantly being dragged into this final outing. This doesn't sound like he's placed in the driver's seat in the film at all. Indiana Jones has always entered an adventure on his own terms, and the leaks make it sound more like he's this babysitter throughout the film, being coached and reprimanded by this other co-star. Anyway, I digress. Now, I'm heading into spoiler territory here, so please continue watching with caution. For your information, I'm kind of hoping that all these spoilers are some big fake and that Indy 5 is far better than I or anyone else can dream of, and that the leaks are just fake leaks and that we'll be cinematically and emotionally blown away. But we shall see. Anyway, here I go. Now, apparently in Indy 5 at the start, we see him close to retirement in 1969, living alone and separated from Marion because of the hardship Mutt's death had put on their marriage since Mutt died in Vietnam, which is apparently mentioned and not shown. Okay, so let me stop there. So again, we start a film without Marion, where that needs patching up again.
I'm your goddamn partner!
Third time now, actually. Remember Raiders and Crystal Skull? The leaks also report that at the end of Indy 5, Marion finally comes back and the two have a nice reconnection, which is reminiscent of the boat scene in Raiders. So no progress here, but regress. At least with Crystal Skull, when Indy got Marion, there was a bonus. He got married and got a full-grown son. No diaper-changing duties for him. So Indy 5 is undoing a whole bunch of stuff, only to be put back together again, the same as it was before. It's like me stealing my wife's chocolate out of the cupboard, and I confess to it, only to go and buy exactly the same one. Not only did she have to wait longer to eat it, but it's the same one. I mean, I could have bought her a better one or something else as well. So how can we fix this? Let's change his motivation at the start of the film, building on what the previous films have done and not to rob the audience. Keywords: build, continue, progress. So here we go again. Opening credit sequence. Let's make this 1938 and not 1944 like the leaks are mentioning. Just before the events of The Last Crusade, where he met Elsa. I'll explain later. Let's start with the same reported adventure with young Indy on a quest to recover the dial, the train scenes, the castle scenes, all of this, which sets up the MacGuffin. Love it. But now, show him returning home to find his relationship with Marion on very rocky ground, and it shows where Indy leaves Marion a week before the wedding. Now, 1969, same as the leaks, we see Indy at work, retirement day, but he's still very much married and not separated. And Mutt has passed away prior in Vietnam. Indy gets a phone call. It's Marion's doctor. Her cancer has advanced. We learn Indy has had a great marriage since Crystal Skull, and what follows is a sad scene of Marion's death and funeral. At the funeral, enter Helena, who is not the goddaughter but is actually Mutt's widow. She's there to pay her respects, but has a very indifferent and strained relationship with Indy, blaming Indy for Mutt's death. Maybe Indy forced Mutt to go to Vietnam, I don't know. But Helena misses Mutt. The story of the dial resurfaces and Indy and Helena are motivated by the prospect of turning back time or to buy back time to spend more time with their loved ones. Maybe they can sort of be put against each other a little bit in the film. Again, a rescue mission. Indy is in the driver's seat, his last hurrah to better things. And what follows is the standard Indy flick, very much of what will reportedly happen in Indy 5. But at its very core, it's a father-daughter story of Helena's acceptance, appreciation of Indy, much like Henry Sr.'s acceptance of Indy in The Last Crusade. Fast forward, and borrowing from other ideas here that I've read, is that during the final act, old Indy, Helena and Vola end up in 1939 successfully, not Greece
over 2,000 years ago.
So now, old Indy realizes the dial doesn't work the way he thought and more time with Marion in the future is not possible. But in finding his younger self in 1939 for help, he encourages the younger Indy to go and be with Marion, to not run away and wait until 1957.
Yes, sir.
I know, very Captain America, right? But bear with me. They enlist young Indy's help to return back to 1969 while Vola tries to undo the past, correcting Hitler's mistakes. Young Indy, old Indy, and Helena stops Vola, and once again our main antagonist gets destroyed by the very artifact they're after. And this is where I'm a little bit upset. Reportedly in the leaks, Vola dies during a plane crash. What? What I loved about how the previous bad guys died is that their demise was the very thing they thought would save or help them. Tot gets melted by the Ark, Molaram dies trying to hold on to the Shankara Stone, Walter Donovan drinks from the wrong cup, and Irina Spalko, she loses her mind and disintegrates. And so far from the leaks, I've learned, and I hope they're wrong, that they are not learning and following the pattern that we all love. Whether cognitively, it doesn't matter. They have worked thus far. So Vola doesn't die in the plane crash. No, he dies at the hand of the Dial, and in some fantastical way he gets, I don't know, time machine where, you know, time just goes normal around him, but he kind of speeds up in the middle and just poof, disintegrates. So in the end, we're left with old Indy, young Indy, and Helena all alive. And during the previous kerfuffle, young Indy lost his hat. In the final scenes, old Indy comes to terms that he has had a good life and that he can't get Mutt or Marin back.
Well, that's fine.
A damn good, really good life.
Well, so have I.
Yeah? You still leaving a trail of human wreckage, or have you retired?
So he urges young Indy to make his life count and that he still has time. See what I did there?
How much of human life is lost in waiting?
Helena and old Indy finally resolve their differences right there, and maybe she calls him Dad for the first time. A nod to The Last Crusade.
Indiana. Indiana.
The portal opens, and just as we see old Indy and Helena walk off into the warm glow reminiscent of the sunset at the end of The Last Crusade, we see old Indy turn to young Indy, and just like in the young Indy scene in The Last Crusade, he caps him with his hat, mantling him for his last mission with Marion. Helena and old Indy disappear for good, leaving young Indy in 1939. Cut to black. 1939, the final scene. Fade up. We hear a knock on the door. Marion opens and sees young Indy at the door.
Indiana Jones.
Young Indy asks for forgiveness and declares his love to Marion. Marion takes him in and asks if he wants to meet someone. She leads him into the nursery where his young baby son is lying in his crib. He embraces, cradles Mutt in his arms for the first time, and hugs Marion. Indy is home. Fade to black. So, right there you have meaning. Again, the restoration theme in Indy's life is present. The motivation again is a rescue mission, putting him back in the driver's seat. And the character arc? Well, old Indy learns to accept his adventurous life that we all know and love, and the choices he has made. And the prize? He gains a daughter. Not to mention what happens in young Indy's life. But most importantly, you're building on the previous events of the films and not undoing it. So, these are just some of my ideas on what they could do. At the very least, I hope that the leaks I'm aware of are completely wrong and that we'll get something far better than what I've just offered. So, thanks for watching everyone. Please leave a comment on what you'd love to see at the end of Indy 5.